Good afternoon, students. I welcome you all for your GATE 2020 lecture. So today's lecture is sponsored by AICTE under Prerna scheme. So today's topic is transportation engineering, which is conducted by Priyanka Kamle ma'am. So please pay attention. Priyanka ma'am, you can start with your lecture. Thank you. Students, I am Priyanka Petkar from Tulsiramji Gaikwad Patil College of Engineering, and today my topic is highway pavements. Okay, so now I am going to share with you a screen. I think I am audible, and you can see the screen even.
Yes, ma'am, your audio is clear and screen is also visible.
Okay. Today my topic is highway pavements. Okay. So just highway pavement is a structure consisting
of interrupt you, ma'am.
Superimposed layers of processed materials above the natural soil subgrade, whose primary function is to distribute the applied vehicle loads to the subgrade. So what is the primary function of the pavements? That is that it distributes the vehicle load, whichever the vehicle is, it distribute the vehicle load to the subgrade. Okay, the pavement structure should be able to provide a surface of 1 second, guys. Okay, the pavement structure should be able to provide a surface of acceptable riding quality, adequate skid resistance, favorable light reflecting characteristic, and low noise pollution. The ultimate aim is to ensure that the transmitted stresses due to wheel load are sufficiently reduced so that they will not exceed the bearing capacity of the grade. So there are some two types of pavements are generally, like first one is flexible pavements and second one is rigid pavements. Okay, then first of all, requirement of the pavements. Okay, there are some required that we have to meet that requirements. Okay, so first one is sufficiently thickness to distribute the wheel load stresses to a safe value on the subgrade soil. Okay, therefore this is the first requirement, that pavement thickness should be very much symmetrical, so that the wheel load stresses to a safe value on the subgrade soil. Okay, structurally stand to withstand all types of stresses imposed upon it. Adequate coefficient of friction to prevent skidding of vehicles. Okay, there should be the adequate coefficient of friction to prevent the skidding. Okay, smooth surface to provide comfort to road users even at high speed. Produce least noise from moving vehicles. Dustproof surface so that the track safety is not impaired by reducing visibility. Impervious surface so that subgrade soil is well protected. Long design life with low maintenance cost. Okay, there are, again I said, there are two types of pavement. First one is flexible and second one is rigid pavement. This is the typical flexible pavement and rigid pavement photos, in which first layer is existing soil, of course, then second one is sub-base soil, sub-base, then base course. okay, and then the surface course, or in only the difference is in flexible pavement there is surface course, and in typical rigid pavement there is a PCC. okay, so baki jo surface course and what is the difference between surface course and PCC, that will show in a next slide or in a okay. So these are the flexible pavements. So flexible pavement will transmit load traces to a lower layers by grain to grain transfer through the points of contact in the granule structure. The wind load acting on the pavement will be distributed to wider area, and the stresses decreases with the depth. Okay, in the flexible pavement, what happened in flexible pavement, the wind load acting, the wind load should be, wind load acting on the pavement will be that wind load is distributed to a wider area and the stresses decreases. So because of that, the stresses were decreases. Taking advantage of this stresses distribution characteristic, flexible pavements normally has many layers. Hence the design of flexible pavement uses the concept of layered system. Okay, as we said, as I said here, the in a typical flexible pavement there is a surface core, but in a surface core there is also many layers, which are like tack coat, seal coat or prime coat. Okay, there are many layers in the surface course also. Because of that, what happened now, when any vehicles goes from the surface course, the load of that wheel was distributed in a wider area. Hence therefore the design of flexible pavement uses the concept of layered system. That's why in a typical flexible pavements we design the layered system. Okay, there is, we use the concept of layered system. These are some typical photos of flexible pavements. Okay, then the typical layers of flexible pavement, here you can see that the first one is a natural formation, then formation level, then sub base, then base course, and surface dressing. Okay, there is, this is one of the cross section of the flexible pavement. You can see that in this, the first or we can say the top layer is surface dressing, then the second layer is surface course, then third layer is base course, and then fourth layer is sub base. And the middle one, that's sub base course and sandwich between the formation level. Okay, natural formation, we are not going to disturb that natural formation. After that, the formation level, even the base sub base course, we are, many times we are not going to disturb that sub base course also. Okay, so typical layers of conventional flexible pavements include seal coat. Okay, so we can see that the seal coat. One second. Seal coating or pavement sealing is the process of applying a protective coating to asphalt-based pavement to provide a layer of protection from the elements like water, oils, and UV damage. Also, the effects of asphalt sealers have been debated. Okay, so there are some benefits also. Seal coat or pavement sealer is a coating for asphalt-based pavement. The top of the asphalt pavements is said to oxidize and delay when it left unprotected. Okay, the seal coat serves as the asphalt's protective barrier against wear, freezing, and vehicle leaks. Seal coat is marketed as a protective coating that extends the life of asphalt pavements. There is not any independent. Okay, the seal coating may reduce the friction or anti-skid properties associated with the exposed aggregates in asphalt. There are some types of seal coating also. First one is refined tar based, that is coal tar based, asphalt based. Second one is asphalt based. Then third one is acrylic. We can say acrylic is a paint, kind of a paint. Then after fourth one is fast dry. Then fifth one is oil based. Okay. There are many application methods of that. Prior to application, the surface must be completely clean and dry using sweeping methods or blowers. If the surface is not clean and dry, then poor adhesion will result. Okay, the pavement sealer are applied with either pressurized spray equipment or self-propelled squeezes method machines, or by hand with a brush. Equipment must be continuous agitation to maintain consistency of a seal coat mix. The process is typically a two coat application, which requires 24 to 48 hours in of curing before vehicle can be allowed on the surface. Okay, once the surface is properly prepared, then properly mixed sealer will be applied at about 1.5 square meters per liter. Okay, this is about the seal coat. Okay, so seal coat like surface coat, stack coat, binder coat, prime coat, base coat, these are the layers in between the surface coats, as we see in the first picture. Okay, this is a surface coat, like look at the typical flexible pavement. Okay, in that surface coat, in that surface coat also there are many layers, in which first one is seal coat, then tack coat, then prime coat. Okay, there are many types of layers also. Okay, then the second one is of course tack coat. Okay, tack coat is very light application of asphalt. Usually asphalt emulsion is diluted with the water. It provides proper bonding between two layer of binder coats and must be thin, uniformly cover the entire surface and set very fast. Okay, tack coat is a sprayed application of an asphalt binder upon an existing asphalt or Portland cement concrete pavement. Prior to an overlay or between layers of new asphalt concrete, other distresses can also be made related to poor tack coat bonding, most notably pavement fatigue cracking. Okay, what is the use of the tack coat? The tack coat is an adhesive material applied between layers of the asphalt concrete that is laid down for road construction. The adhesive, when applied correctly, helps to prevent the degradation of the road by keeping the asphalt concrete layers together. Okay, what is the difference between the prime coat and tack coat? A prime coat is an application of an asphalt cutback or emulsified asphalt to a prepare base. Tack is an adhesive or gluing two asphalt layers together. A subgrade or rock base is not a single component. Where is the tack coat is applied then? A tack coat is a thin bituminous liquid asphalt emulsion or cutback layer applied between the pavement's lifts to promote bonding. Okay, what is the necessity of tack coat? The tack coat also greatly reduces the amount of sliding or slippage failures that may occur between the existing pavement surface. Okay, thus the proper application of the tack coat is very important in the long-term durability of the asphalt concrete pavement. Why the prime coats and tack coat were used? Then tack and prime coat help to protect pavements from water damage and can prevent slipping or slick asphalt surfaces. A tack coat or bond coat is a thin layer of asphalt emulsion applied specifically between hot mix asphalt pavement lifts to help the bonding processes. Then what is the coat, from which material the tack coat is made of? It is an asphalt emulsion. The trick is to take it, the very sticky thick bituminous asphalt and grind the particles very finely. This is done in what is called a colloidal mill. Okay, then tack coat is very light application of asphalt, of course, that as I said. Then there are some typical layers of flexible pavement. First one is the prime coat. Then prime coat is an application of low viscous cutback bituminous to an absorbent surface like granule basis on which binder layer is placed. It provides bonding between two layers. Unlike tack coat, prime coat, tacked coat or prime coat penetrates into the layer below, plugs the voids, and forms a watertight surface. So prime coat is an application of low viscosity asphalt to a granule base in preparation for an initial layer or surface of asphalt. Okay, then why prime coat is applied? The prime coat is basically designed to harden or toughen the base surface to provide adhesion between the base and the asphaltic courses, to coat and bond loose aggregate particles, and to waterproof the surface of the base. Where the prime coat is used then? The prime coat is mainly responsible for protecting the surface of a construction project before adding additional layers. In asphalt preparation, they can also act as a binder with secondary and tertiary compounds, creating a better adhesion between the layers. Then how do you apply the prime coat? Coat and bond loose material particles on the surface of on the base, harder or toughen the base course, sorry, the base surface to provide a work platform for construction equipment. Plug capillary voids in the base course surface to prevent migration of moisture. Provide adhesion between the base course and succeeding asphalt course. Then when should you apply that prime coat? When an asphalt emulsion is used, it should normally be applied at a temperature between 120 degree to 160 degree. When an asphalt binder is used, it should normally be applied at a temperature between 275 and 325. Okay, 325 degrees, that is in farads F. So this is about the prime coat. Prime coat is an application of low viscous cutback bitumen into an absorbent surface like granule basis on which binder layer is placed. Then this is about the surface course. Surface course, of course, the surface course is the layer directly in contact with the traffic loads and generally contains superior quality materials. They are usually constructed with dense graded asphalt concrete. It provides characteristics such as friction, smoothness, drainage, etc. Also, it will prevent the entrance of excessive quantities of surface water into the underlying base, subbase and subgrade. It must be tough to resist the distortion under traffic and provide a smooth and skid resistant riding surface. It must be waterproof to protect the entire base and subgrade from the weakening effect of water. The wearing course, in that there is a wearing course also. The wearing course is the upper layer in roadway, airfield and a dockyard construction. The term surface course is sometimes used. However, this term is slightly different as it can be used to describe very thin surface layers such as chip seal. The surface course of a flexible pavement protect the underlying base course from traffic and water while also providing adequate tire friction, generating minimal noise in urban areas and giving suitable light reflecting for nighttime driving. Then what are the different surface courses? There are wide range of asphalt type that can be utilized as a surface course. This includes hot rolled asphalt, asphalt concrete, concrete asphalt, porous asphalt and Natratex. What is the surface course in flexible pavement? The surface course or wearing course is the topmost layer of flexible pavement which has direct contact with the vehicle load. The main function of a surface course is to provide skid resistance, surface friction and drainage of the pavement. It should be watertight against surface water infiltration. Then what is the difference between the surface course and the binder course? In general, the asphalt layers are paved on a bound or unbound road base layers. Starting at the road surface, the first layer is called the surface course. The second layer is mostly called the binder course. The lower layer are the basis course. Then the primary function of a pavement is to transist load to the subbase and underlying soil. Modern flexible pavements contain sand and gravel or crushed stone compacted with the binder or bituminous material such as asphalt, tar or asphaltic oil, such as the pavement has enough plasticity to absorb shocks. It is composed of course, surface course is composed of bituminous material, surface course and underlying base and subbase courses. The bituminous material is more often asphalt, whose viscous nature allows significant plastic deformation. Okay, in transport engineering, subgrade is the native material underneath a constructed road, pavement or railway track. It is also called formation level. The term can also refer to imported material that has been used to build an embankment. This is about the binder course. This layer provides the bulk of an asphalt concrete structure. Its chief purpose is to distribute load to the base course. The binder course generally consists of aggregates having less asphalt and doesn't require quality as high as the surface course. So replacing a part of the surface course results in more economical design. Okay, so binder course means a layer of hot mix asphalt that is called, we can call it as HMA, that is hot mix asphalt, that may contain RAS and is located between the top course and aggregate base in the construction of asphalt paving structures. There are some functions of the binder courses. This layer provides the bulk of the asphalt concrete structure. Its purpose is to distribute load on the base course. The binder course generally consists of aggregates having less asphalt and doesn't require quality as high as the surface course. So the binder course sits between the surface and the base course, where its key function is to distribute the load to the base course. What is the binder in asphalt? Okay, so in its most common form, asphalt binder is simply the residue from petroleum refining. To achieve the necessary properties for paving purposes, binder must be produced from a carefully chosen crude oil blend and processed to an appropriate grade. Asphalt concrete, commonly called as asphalt, blacktop, and tarmac, bitumen macadam, or we can say it as rolled asphalt. Okay. Then there is one thing is that is the binder base. So base binder are used in an under layer for the grip packs of the day to improve durability. They have a tacky consistency and help improve how the wax of the day will stick on the sky base. So it's great idea to apply a couple of layers of the base binder if you are planning on skiing more than 10 kilometer, or if the snow is icy. Then asphalt binder viscosity measures a fluid's resistance to flow and is typically measured to replicate the HMA, that is hot mix asphalt pavement surface temperature during the summer. Okay. Then what is the binder coat in paving? The binder, which is sometimes called as the base coat, is load-bearing course consisting of aggregate and hot mix asphalt. Because the binder must be strong, it typically contains aggregate that are approximately 0.75 inch in size. There are three types of binder asphalt. Okay, so first, mixes are a coarser grade or blacktop containing a higher percentage of larger stones. These larger stones increase in stability when added to the asphalt mix and also raises the load factor the surface can endure before breaking or cracking. So this is about the binder course. Okay, then the base course. The base course is the layer of material immediately beneath the surface of binder course, and it provides additional load distribution and contributes to the subsurface drainage. It may be composed of crushed stone, crushed slag, and other untreated or stabilized material. The base course or sub-base course or base course in pavement is a layer of material in asphalt roadway, racetrack, riding arena, riding area or sporting field. It is located under the surface layer consisting of the wearing courses and sometimes an extra binder courses. What is the meaning of binder course then? The first or lowest course of a wall, or we can say the road, the foundation wall or the wall of a building above the basement, the bottom layer of the material laid down in the construction of a pavement. Then what is the purpose of the base course, or why it is necessary? It provides uniform and stable support. Then second one is the minimize damage effects of frost action. Then third one is it provides drainage. Then fourth one is provide pumping of fine grained soils at joints. Then fifth one is prevent volume change of the subgrade. Then fifth one, six, sorry, sixth one is increase structural capacity of the pavement. Okay, then these are some type, these are the necessity or we can say the functions of the sub base course. Okay, so as I said, first one is provide uniform and stable support. Then second one is minimize damaging effects of frost action. Then third one is provide drainage. It also provide the drainage. Then fourth one is prevent pumping of fine grain soils at joints. Then fifth one is prevent volume change of the subgrade. Then sixth one is increase structural capacity of the pavement. So base course, the layer immediately beneath the surface course. Okay, this is the layer immediately beneath the surface course. It provides additional load distribution and contributes to drainage. Base courses are usually constructed out of crush aggregates or HMA. The sub base generally consists of lower quality material than the base course, but better than the subgrade soils. So base course refers to the sub base layers of an asphalt roadway, generally consisting of layer grade aggregates spread the compacted to provide a stable base for further layers of aggregate or asphalt pavement. Aggregate base course is often referred to as okay. Then in transport engineering, subgrade is the native material underneath a constructed road, pavement or railway track. It is also called formation level. The term can also refer imported material that has been used to build an embankment. Then there is some function of the subgrade also. The subgrade soil and its properties are important in the design of pavement structure. The main function of the subgrade is to give the adequate support to the pavement, and for this the subgrade should possess sufficient stability under adverse climatic and loading conditions. Okay, this is about the base course. Then there is a sub base course also. The sub base course is the layer of material beneath the sub base course, and the primary function are to provide structural support and improve drainage and reduce the intrusion of fines from the subgrade in the pavement structure. If the base course is open graded, then the sub base course with more fines can serve as a filler between the subgrade and the base course. As a base course is not always needed or used. For example, a pavement constructed over a high quality stiff subgrade may not need the additional features offered by a sub base course. In such situations, sub base course may not be provided. Okay, then the subgrade layer, as I said, the subgrade and sub bases. Okay, so what is the sub base and subgrade? In highway engineering, sub base is the layer of aggregate material laid on the subgrade on which the base course layers is located. It may be omitted when there will be only foot traffic on the pavement, but it is necessary for surfaces used by vehicles. Sub base is often the main load bearing layers of the pavement. Okay, then what is the base material for the subgrade? A base material is a parent material to which a coating or plating is applied. The term base material helps to differentiate between the overall part, the various layers, and the original base material, a base material known as the subgrade. A clay soil generally has a low CBR value, the low CBR less than 8, sands are more granular and drain better, will generally have CBR values between 15 and 35, gravel will have the best CBR value, generally 25 and up. That is why it is suggested to save the base material to cap the subgrade. Then how do you lay the base course? The base course is compacted granular fill used to build up areas, set levels, and provides a strong stable layers to support the laid pavers. Fill in the base course no thicker than 100 mm and compact to a uniform dense condition, especially around manholes and curbs. If more than 100 mm is needed, compact in layers. Okay, then what is the coarse gravel? Coarse gravel is the biggest type of the gravel and feature optimum drainage and could support the heftiest of loads. Okay, medium gravel, on the other hand, medium gravel is the type of the gravel is to go to for the majority of pavers. This is about the subgrade. The topsoil or subgrade is a layer of natural soil prepared to receive the stresses from the layers above. It is essential that at no time soil subgrade is overstressed. It should be compacted to the desirable density near the optimum moisture content. Okay, then this is about the rigid pavements. Okay, rigid pavements have sufficient flexural strength to transmit the wheel load stresses to a wider area below compared to flexible pavements. Rigid pavements are placed either directly on the prepared subgrade or a single layer of granule or stabilized material. Since there is only one layer of material between the concrete and subgrade, this layer can be called as a base or subbase course. Okay, so rigid pavement is a technical term for any road surface made of concrete. Concrete roads are called rigid while asphalt covered roads are flexible. The basic design of rigid pavement is very simple. A surface layer made up of slabs of Portland cement concrete sits on the top of a handful of sublayers. One second, guys. Then there are two main types of road construction. Rigid pavements such as a concrete can only be used on a stable ground. Flexible pavements such as bituminous material as described below can be used on a ground where some movement is expected. What is the difference between the flexible and rigid pavement? Flexible pavements tend to have more layers and are therefore much thicker by default. Rigid pavements have fewer layers and are thinner than flexible pavement, which makes them susceptible to more repairs over time. What is the rigid pavement and its types? Rigid pavement can be classified into four types: jointed plain concrete pavement, that is JPCP, jointed reinforced concrete pavement, JR, jointed continuous reinforced concrete pavements. Okay. What do you mean by flexible pavement and rigid pavement? Flexible pavement are those which are surfaced with bituminous or asphalt materials. On the other hand, rigid pavements are composed of a PCC surface course, such as pavements are substantially stiffer than flexible pavement due to the high modulus of elasticity of the PCC material. What is the subgrade? So these are some pictures of rigid pavements. Then these are some pavement materials. First one is soil. Pavements are a coagulation of material. These materials, their associated properties and their interaction determine the properties of the resultant pavement. There's a good understanding of these materials, how they are characterized and how they are performed. They perform is fundamental to understanding pavement. The materials which are used in the construction are of intense to a highway engineer. Then the second one is subgrade soil. Then soil is an accumulation or deposit of earth material derived naturally from the disintegration of rocks or decay of vegetation. Decay of vegetation that can be excavated readily with the proper power equipment in the field or disintegrated by gentle mechanical means in the laboratory. The supporting soil beneath pavement and its special undercourses is called subgrade. Undistributed soil beneath the pavement is called natural subgrade. Compacted subgrade is the soil compacted by controlled movement of heavy compactors. A subgrade is made up of native soil that has been compacted to withstand the loads above it. There is no consistency in regard to the terms of subbase and subgrade, but normally the subgrade is the native soil while the subbase is the layer of soil or aggregate on the top of the subgrade. Which soil is used for the subgrade? there are some many types of soil like sandy soils, silty soils, then clay soils, organic soils. There are many types of soils. Okay, then the purpose of, what is the purpose of subgrade soil? Then the subgrade must be able to support load transmitted from the pavement structure. This load bearing capacity is often affected by the degree of compaction, moisture content and soil type. A subgrade that can be support high amount of loading without excessive deformation is considered good. Then what is the strength of the subgrade soil? Okay, generally the highway engineer is interested in the stability or the deformation of the soil under the stress application. In a soil mass, the deformation is largely due to slippage between the soil particles. Hence, the shearing resistance in soil represents strength. A clay good for the good for subgrade. As the application, I guess A7, A76 are related as a fair to poor subgrade soil. However, when designing pavement structure, a subgrade soil was classified as a frost susceptible as following the characteristics. Okay, this is about the subgrade soil. Then pavement materials. The first one is a soil type. The wide range of soil types available as highway construction materials have made it obligatory on the part of the highway engineer to identify and classify different soils broadly. The soil types can be categorized as laterite soil, murram, red soil or desert sands, alluvial soil, clay including black cotton soil. Okay, the first one is the gravel. These are coarse materials with particle size under 2.36 mm with little or no fines contributing to cohesion of materials. Okay, then the murum. These are products of decomposition and weathering of the pavement rock. Visually, these are similar to gravel except presence of higher content of the fines. Then the silts. These are finer than sand, brighter in colors as compared to clay and exhibit little cohesion. When lump of silty soil makes its appearances, the dilutancy is a specific property of such soil. Clays. These are finer than silts. Clay soils exhibit thickness, high strength when dry and show no dilutancy. Black cotton soil and other expansive clays exhibit swellings and shrinkage properties. Paste of clay with water when rubbed in between fingers leaves stain, which is not observed for silts. This is the cross section or cut section of the rigid pavement. So topmost layer, or we can see the bottommost layer, is the subgrade. Then the formation level is the subgrade between the subgrade and subbase. Okay, then third one is the subbase, and then the concrete slab. Okay, so there are two stages of mixed design of bituminous pavement. First one is dry mix design and second one is the wet mix design. Okay, so 1 second. So in the bituminous mix design, we will determine the first one, how these are some stages. Okay, so first one is proportion of bitumen, and we have to find out, first of all, we have to find the proportion of bitumen, and then the fine aggregate required for the pavement design and construction. Second one, we have to find out the required fine aggregate for the pavement design and construction. Then third one, we have to find out, or we have to determine the coarse aggregate for the construction. Then the fourth one, that we have to find out the filler materials which are required for the filler materials. Okay, then what is the dry mix design? The objective of dry mix design is to determine the amount of various sizes of mineral aggregate to use to get a mix of maximum density. The dry mix design involves three important steps. Crush aggregates and sharp sand produce high stability of the mix when compared with gravel and rounded. Okay, then what is the bitumen mix design? The bituminous mix design aims to determine the proportion of bitumen filler, fine aggregates and coarse aggregate to produce a mix which workable, strong, durable and economical. Then we have to also find out the aggregate proportion. The art of determining the quantities of the various ingredients so as to obtain the densest and the most economical called proportioning of aggregate. The principle of proportioning of aggregate is that the smaller particle will fill up the voids between large particles. Okay, then why dry mix proportion or why dry mix design we used for? Then dry mix is an acronym to help you to remember how variables are plotted on a graph. It also serves as a reminder that there are two names for each variable because scientists have not reached an agreement. Okay, so these are some steps. That the first one is proportion of bitumen, and we have to determine the proportion of bitumen, then the required fine aggregate for the pavement design, then the required coarse aggregate, then filler materials required. Okay, these are some objectives of bituminous mix design. The main objective of the bitumen is to proportion various components for pavement construction to achieve the following objectives. To obtain a durable pavement, sufficient amount of bitumen is required. To obtain a durable pavement, sufficient amount of bitumen is required. Adequate strength must be provided to obtain resistance against the shear deformation under high temperatures. Additional voids have to incorporate it to facilitate the compaction performed by the traffic. The placement must be performed this with ease, which will demand sufficient workability. The premature cracking in the bitumen pavement can be avoided by providing sufficient flexibility for the bitumen. The flexibility must be attained at smaller temperatures so that the shrinkage cracks can be avoided. These are the main constituents of bitumen and mix. First one is the coarse and fine aggregate, then the filler, then the binder. Okay, there are different types of mix that can be prepared. They involved, first one is open graded bituminous mix, well graded bituminous mix, then gap graded bituminous mix, then unbounded bituminous mix. Okay, the bituminous mix design aims to determine the proportion of bitumen filler, finer, fine aggregates and coarse aggregate to produce a mix which workable, strong, durable and economical. Then what are the desirable properties of good bituminous mix? The desirable properties of good bituminous mixes, like first one is the stability, then second durability, then the cohesion, then the skid resistance and workability. If bituminous mix is poor in any of the above properties, then that mix ultimately result in pavement failure. Okay, then there is again one mix design, that is we can say the Marshall mix design method. The Marshall mix design method was originally developed by Bruce Marshall of the Mississippi Highway Department in 1939. The main idea of the Marshall mix design method involves the selection of the asphalt binder content with a suitable density which satisfied minimum stability and range of flow values. So how do you calculate the bituminous concrete? There are some methods in which we can calculate the bituminous concrete. Okay, so find out, the first one is we have to find out the road thickness, that is dimension, width and thickness. Then we have to find out, calculate the volume of asphalt, that is long, how much long it, and then the multiplied with the weight and thickness. Okay, that should be in a m cube. Then find out the density of asphalt, then calculate the quantity of asphalt. These are some steps by which we can find out the bituminous concrete. Okay, there are some steps in which we can find out, or we can methods consist of these are the mixed design steps. We can see the first one is the aggregate selection, then second one is the asphalt binder selection, then the third one is the sample preparation, that includes compaction also, then the stability determination, stability determination using the stabilometer. Then we have to also find out the density and voids calculation. Then optimum asphalt binder content selection. Okay. There are many, of course, I used to say it, but there are different types of mix that can be prepared. First one is the open graded bituminous mix, then well graded bituminous mix, gap graded bituminous mix. Okay. Gap graded bituminous mix, then unbounded bituminous mix. Okay. Then first one is the open graded mix. The filler and the finer aggregate are absent. These mixes are porous in nature and offer good frictional properties. This lower the strength if the pavement is constructed for a high speed pavement construction. Then the gap graded bituminous mix. As the name implies, large coarse aggregate are missing in these types of mix. This has good fatigue property as well as tensile strength. Then the third one is the well graded mix. A well-graded mix is a dense mix. These have all ranges of aggregates and are sufficiently packed. This facilitates the proper filling of voids in a systematic manner. These types of mix offer good compressive strength and tensile strength. Okay, these are some photos in which this is about the concrete mix. Not a concrete mix, it's a pavement design. Okay. तो इसमें पेमेंट डिजाइन हो चुका है. वी हैव टू जस्ट कैलकुलेट दैट. देन आफ्टर दैट ओनली पेमेंट जो है वो रेडीली बना रहे हो. ओके. सो लेयर्स इन अ बिटुमिनस पेमेंट. सो फर्स्ट वन इज द बेस कोर्स, देन बाइंडिंग बाइंडर कोर्स, देन कॉन्क्रीट लेयर ऑफ बिटुमिन और एसफॉल्ट. सो एज आई सेड, द लोअर मोस्ट लेयर इज द नेचुरल सबग्रेड, देन कॉम्पैक्टेड सबग्रेड, देन थर्ड लेयर इज सब बेस कोर्स, देन फोर्थ लेयर इज बेस कोर्स, देन बाइंडर कोर्स, एंड देन द सर्फेस कोर्स, एंड देन द सील कोट. ओके. तो टैक कोट इज लाइक अ सैंडविच बिटवीन द सर्फेस कोर्स एंड बाइंडर कोर्स, एंड द प्राइम कोट इज सैंडविच बिटवीन, दैट इज द बाइंडर मटेरियल, और वी कैन से द बाइंडर कोट for a binder course and base course. Then seal coat is the last application or last coat, okay, on the surface course. These are the basic requirement of bituminous mix. First one is the good stability, then second one is good durability, then workability should be good, skid risk, that should be the skid resistance, then the flexibility must be there. Okay, the stability of bituminous mix, the resistance of the pavement towards the deformation under action of vehicle or the dynamic load is called as the stability of the bituminous mix. The two main types examples of failure caused in the bituminous pavement due to lack of stability are shoeing and grooving. Okay, then skid resistance of bituminous pavement. The skid resistance is the resistance of the pavement against the skidding action of the vehicle. This is mainly related to the surface texture of the pavement. The bitumen content also influences this property to a large extent. In high speed traffic condition, this is an essential factor to be considered. An open graded coarse surface will help in providing maximum skid resistance. Okay. Okay, so there are some main objectives of bituminous mix: to design a proportion various components for pavements constructed to achieve the following objective. To first one is to obtain a durable pavement, sufficient amount of bitumen is required. Then second one is adequate strength must be provided to obtain resistance against the shear deformation under high temperature. Then additional voids have to be incorporated to facilitate the compaction performed by the traffic. The placement must be performed with each ease with which will demand sufficient workability. Okay. The premature cracking is the bitumen pavement can be avoided by providing sufficient flexibility for the bitumen. The flexibility must be attained at smaller temperature so that the shrinkage cracks can be avoided. Then there are some constituents of bituminous pavement. The first one is coarse and fine aggregate, then filler and binder, as I said earlier. The base coarse, the coarse aggregates are known for their abrasion resistance and toughness. These aggregates offer compressive and shear strength to the mix. These also facilitate good interlocking properties between aggregates. Example for this type of aggregates are granites. The fine aggregates fill the voids in the mix created by the coarse aggregates and provide stiffening to the binder. Example of fine aggregates used are sand and rock dust. Fillers play the role of filling the voids. They help in stiffening the binder and offer higher permeability. Example for this type of the fillers are cement, lime and rock dust. Okay, the binders also play the role of filling the voids. This help to undergo particle adhesion and for gluing purpose. This hence increase the impermeability property of the pavement. Example for this type of binder are bitumen and tar and asphalt. In case of open grade mixes, the filler and the finer aggregates are absent. These mixes are porous in nature and offer good frictional properties. This lower the strength in the pavement in constructed for a high speed pavement construction. The layer of mineral aggregate like gravel, stones and sand together form a bituminous base coarse layer. This layer is treated as the foundation for the laying the binder and the surface course. The bituminous binder course is the second layer above the base course, which act as the first layer of bitumen. This is done in two layers resurfacing. This is also called as leveling course. The third layer is the concrete form of bitumen or asphalt. The bituminous concrete is a combination of aggregate that is continuously graded from the maximum size, which is mainly less than 25 mm, to the fine filler of size smaller than 0.075 to make the mix sufficiently impervious. This provides a layer will have acceptable levels of dissipative and elastic properties. Then there are some basic requirements of a bituminous. So as I said, good stability, good durability, workability, then skid resistance, then flexibility. Stability of bituminous. And the stability of bitumen pavement is influenced by the following parameters. In interparticle friction between the aggregate, then cohesion offered within the bitumen bond within the all particles. Okay. The stability is determined by sufficient bonding between the particle. This requires adequate amount of binder so that it coats the particle at the time when it offers friction. There are also chances to have a lower value of stability when the binder content is large and the particle of the mix are kept apart without any kind of the bond. Durability of the bitumen. Okay, the resistance of the mix against the external weathering and abrasive action can be called as the durability property. The wind loads and the high abrasion action on the pavement results in the formation of tensile strains. Lack of durability of the pavement result in the following failures like potholes and stripping. Potholes is the local deterioration and stripping is the failure that expose all the aggregate. Higher binder content help in reducing the chances of disintegration to some extent. Then the stability of the bitumen pavement is influenced by the following parameters. Okay, the stability of bitumen is influenced by these are some parameters by which the stability of the bitumen are influenced. Okay, the first one is interparticle friction between the aggregates, then the cohesion offered within the bitumen bond within all the particles. One second, guys. Then the workability of bituminous mix. A bituminous mix have to be easily handled for its proper placement and compaction. This can be only performed if there is sufficient workability for the mix. This property will let the mix to take adequate shape and condition. The workability of the mix depends on the some of the following factors. The aggregate type like angular, flaky and elongates. The content of the bitumen, the gradation of aggregate, shape and texture of the aggregates. Then type of the bitumen. Then there are some flexibility of bitumen mix. The level of bending strength required to counteract the traffic load is called the flexibility property. This is the one type of the one that will help you in preventing the cracking surface of the pavement. The fracture is the cracks that is formed on the surface. The reason behind these fractures are the shrinkage and brittleness. The repeated bending of the surface due to the traffic load over it results in the brittleness. Flexibility is increased with higher bitumen content. Then there are some desirable properties for the bitumen mix. Okay, the first one is the traffic demand has to meet adequately by having sufficient stability. The bitumen mix have to be economical. The bitumen mix must have sufficient workability to help construction procedures. Voids must be intentionally left so that the compaction during the traffic can be performed. The mix must be flexible to face the changing temperature condition. Then there are some factors affecting the pavement designs. The first one is the wheel load, then axle configuration. The third one is the contact pressure. The fourth one is vehicle speed, then the repetition of load, then the subgrade soil, the temperature and precipitation. Then the first one is the wheel load influence on the pavements. Wheel load on pavement is an important factor to determine the pavement thickness. Pavement thickness to be adopted by providing adequate thickness. The load coming from wheels doesn't affect the subgrade soil. The wheel load is acts as a particular point on pavement and causes deformation. If the vehicle contains dual wheels on one side of axle, then convert it into equivalent single wheel load. Dual wheel axle wheels control the contact pressure within the limits. Okay, then these are the some axle configuration. Axles are the important part of the vehicles which enables the wheels to rotate while moving. By providing multiple axles, vehicles can carry more load. So the axle load also influences the design of pavements. In the layer theory of flexible pavement design, wheels on one side of axles are considered to design the pavement. Similarly, in the plate theory of rigid pavement design, wheels on both sides are considered. Okay, then as you say, for like single unit trucks, then conventional combined vehicles, then longer combined vehicles. Okay, these are some types in which we can see the equivalent wheel loads. Okay, then tire contact pressure on pavement. When the vehicle is moving on pavement, the pressure develops between the tire and the pavement. If the tire is low pressure tire, then the contact pressure will be greater than the tire pressure. If it is a higher pressure tire, then the contact pressure will be less than the tire pressure. The original shape of the contact area is generally elliptical, but to ease the calculation, circular shape is considered. Then the vehicle speed. If the vehicle is moving at creep speed, then also the damage occurs to the pavement. If the vehicle speed is gradually increased, then it will cause smaller stress in the pavement. Okay, then repetition of loads. Constructed pavement is used by several vehicles in its design life. The wheel loads are repeated all the time. Due to this, some of the deformation occurs on the pavement. Total deformation is the sum of all wheel loads acting on it. So in the design of pavement, frequency of load is also considered for the design of pavement. A single axle with dual wheels carrying 80 kN load is considered as a standard axle. Like a subgrade soil, subgrade type to construct pavement, subgrade soil need to be tested. Various tests like CBI, triaxial, etc. will help to determine the quality of subgrade. From this we can adapt determine the quality of subgrade. From this we can adapt the required thickness to the pavement. If subgrade soil is poor, then the pavement should damage easily. Okay, then these are some temperature effects on pavement design. So temperature is an important environmental factor to be considered in the design of the pavement. In the case of asphalt road, the temperature affects the resistance modulus of the surface course. In very hot In the case of asphalt road, temperature affects the resistance modulus of the surface course. In very hot condition, asphalt layers lose their stiffness. At low temperature, asphalt layers become brittle and cracks are formed. In case of rigid pavement, temperature stresses are developed. Curling of concrete is also possible due to variation of temperature in the top and bottom layers of pavement. Then the precipitation. Okay. Then the moisture variation or precipitation from rain effect affects the depth of the groundwater table. Good drainage facilities should be provided for good strength and support. The groundwater table should be at least below 1 meter from the pavement surface. Then these are some pavement design like IRC 37-2001 basic principle. Then the first one is the vertical stresses or strain on subgrades. Then second one is tensile stress or strain on surface course. Okay, the factors for design of pavement: static load on wheels, contact pressure, load repetition, subgrade soil. For subgrade soil, thickness of pavement required, stresses, strain behavior under load, then moisture variation, then there is a climatic factor, then pavement component material, then environmental factor, traffic character, required cross-sectional elements for the alignment. These are some pavement responses under load. Okay. Then thank you guys. If you have any query, you can ask me.
Okay, students, so if you have any question, you can ask to Priyanka ma'am.
Anyone experimenter?
Okay, no questions. Okay, thank you so much, Priyanka ma'am. Now you can leave the class. Students, you can also leave the session.
Analysis.